Morning, thanks for coming. You love this spring weather? At the museum, quite. I just took a moment to silence my cell phone. If you were here last night, know that I've already fired both barrels. So I don't have a complicated introduction. I want to begin by saying thank you several times. Houser family for supporting me. Without you. Sorry that Mrs. Houser can't be with us. She's Houses is here with Anna. Reddick, who will speak later, closely on this exhibition. Especially since mine is not. So thanks also to John and Dee Dee Stewart, who supported us. Say a little bit about my about 1975, I was working in a gallery in Austin, Texas that exhibited contemporary Native started becoming aware of a generation of. About that time, three things about Allan. There was a book by Guy and Doris Monthan called Art and Indian Individual, Profiles on 17 Contemporary Artists. Read that book. More or less around the same time, there was a PBS series that featured. And also in 1977, the Sacred Circles exhibition in Kansas. Number of ancillary exhibitions around. Crown Center had an very exciting, very dramatic. So these got me started paying attention. 1982, I was about to start graduate school and I had a chance. Formal interview with him one summer. Gracious and very welcoming. Thoughtful conversation. Not about running a studio. Not art historical conversation, I kind of followed. Found that pretty interesting. That was in 82. In 1990, I heard him speak at the museum in the context of a traveling exhibition called Allan. It was a fascinating afternoon. You know, he told stories. Watching him, I was also watching the audience. I was kind of paying attention. Quite fascinating. People were on the edge of their seat, literally or metaphorically, sort of hanging on. Quiet and soft-spoken, he had an elegance about him. Rustic and honest and plain-spoken, but very. Moment in the afternoon where I thought, you know, if he stands up and quiet, if you will follow me down to the river, everybody would stand up and go out the door with him, right? Had them in the palm of his hand. It was up in the auditorium. After that, in 1996, after Allan had passed, the first by the Wheelwright Museum of the American Indian, junction with the Houser family. Next for that exhibition. First time I really sort of bit off a piece of it and started to think. Seriously. 2002 or thereabouts, Dave and I laptops, we're trying to remember the exact date. Second Idle George Fellowship exhibition. Think again and write about his work. That was a great experience for me. In 2004, the family asked me to write a monument about the same time that he was celebrated at the new National Museum of the American Indian. Person Cheryl with George helped inaugurate the new space. And so recently I've had a chance about the drawings and work project that I conceived in 2006. Some of you may have heard me say last night, plan ahead to get things done on time. That's just a little bit about my historiography, as it were. Working on this exhibition was a real delightful and so rewarding. Half of the Fred Jones Jr. Museum. I tried to name all of them last night. I bet I left somebody out. I'll try to name them all again. All of them for their support. So we thought it would be a good idea to have an educational symposium of about this museum. Not all university art museums care about their educational mission. For all of the students in my graduate work gallery talks about one or two Allan Houser works in there. The relationship between the museum manifestation of the museum. Our first speaker this morning is my friend and colleague Daniel, curator in the Department of Ethnology at the Sam. Oklahoma Museum of Natural History, have the Sam and the Fred, and is also professor in the OU Department of Anthropology. Swan has received numerous awards for his exhibition. Oklahoma Museum Association. Among his many couple in particular, Osage Art, published in 2000. Cody Religious Art, Symbols of Faith and Belief. I have consulted a number. The title of his presentation today is Apache Odyssey, Diaspora, and the Power of Place. Please join me.
Fearful moment. I couldn't get out of my seat. Maybe more of those to come, probably. I also would like to say good morning and thank you for coming out. Appreciate Jack's invitation to participate and take just a moment. I teach a series of museum anthropology courses, and I'd like to echo some of Jack's sentiments in that working with Susan's staff here, I bring my classes over here so that they get a view of the museum world from through the lens of museum anthropology, but through the exciting programs that are offered here. And I think one thing that I would add is the incredible diversity. Truly is a broad-scaled institution of children through old dudes like me. So again, congratulations to them. I'm the anthropologist on the agenda, so it's incumbent upon me. Don't worry, I won't talk about art very much. But it's incumbent upon me to place Mr. Houser and his work and his people into some sort of cultural or historical context, and that's what I'm going to attempt to do. Basically, what I want to talk about today are stories. Try to bring that full circuit back around, and hopefully it will make some sense. In preparing for this, the Apache provide this a great example of this incredibly voluminous literature and other materials that are available through the perspectives of anthropologists, archaeology, linguistics, historians, ethnographers. There's a tremendous amount of material out there, and I think that what's important to me and what I'm going to try to attempt to do here is at least to introduce some of the emerging attempts and efforts on the part of Apache people to add their voices to this ongoing discussion, both through the perpetuation of important aspects of tradition and Apache culture, particularly through oral performance and narrative. But then more importantly, for our purposes today, through a broad range of expressive forms that we're going to hear about throughout the symposium from various speakers. So archaeologists, according to their work, see the emergence of the people that we refer to as Apache into the American Southwest about 1000 AD or current era. Some estimates bring it up very close to the advent of contact with the Spanish, but by all accounts, both archaeological and more importantly from those from the Apache oral literature, they've been residents there for a very long time, but both sources do acknowledge that a migration of sorts, that a journey was involved in the actual placement of the Apache peoples in the locations in which they were first contacted by Europeans, the Spanish, first of all. Linguistically, they're members of the Athabascan language family, which is found primarily in the Arctic, ranging through all of the interior of Alaska down into the Yukon territories, Northwest territories. These are people like the Gwich'in and the Slavey and the Beaver folks. In the Yellowknife region in that area. Also have Athabascan speakers on the Pacific Northwest coast, particularly speakers of Tlingit and various associated dialects. And then, of course, a very large concentration of Athabascan speakers in the American Southwest. Linguists are very structural and organizational in their approach to things, so they've labeled all of this, and obviously you can't read it. It's a lovely shade of chartreuse against gray, but we're focused in the south, what's referred to as the southern group of Athabascan speakers. Now I'll show you a chart that I know you can't read, but they like to do these sorts of things, okay, and branch languages off and talk about the connections and the diversions when particular groups of related speakers emerged as distinct groups. This is a map of the American Southwest. If you take the strip that's in blue here, my Vanna White moment, that's Arizona Territory. So if you take that and the chunk of Texas that hangs out there by El Paso and add that to that, sections of northern Chihuahua and Sonora, Mexican states, you have this region that came to be known, it was named by the Spaniards first, as Apacheria, okay? Now, so this is a term that I wanna delve into and unpack. So basically by the 18th century, these are inferred territorial domains. These would be probably best described as resource areas, but if you move from your left to right, we have the Western Apache, the north of that, the Navajo in the amber color, the Chiricahuas, and then north again to the Jicarillas, the Mescaleros, and then down in southern Texas, the Lipan, and then the brown spot with the PL, are formerly referred to when this was done as the Plains Apache, but today they prefer to be referred to as the Apache tribe of Oklahoma. So by the 19th century, Apache groups controlled a reduced territory, moving west to north. Several historically known groups had achieved distinct geographic expressions. And Apache man's moved with the seasons, hunting, gathering, employing a broad range of resource strategies. And by the 1860s, had basically controlled the territory. These are all very difficult to estimate, but I want to try to give you some scale as to the geographic spread and the political prominence, the prowess of the Apache speaking peoples of the Southwest, but probably controlling an area in excess of 15 million square acres. So a massive, massive resource base. These lifeways were disrupted in the 1850s. As increasing numbers of Europeans moved through, there's a major trail that led to the Arizona Territory and ultimately to Southern California. But the main issue, as it was in many parts of what was then Indian Territory, was mining, all right? As Euro-Americans became more and more increasingly interested in the extraction of mineral resources from the western regions, they increasingly came in first as prospectors and then ultimately as miners, and then quickly followed by a full range of interests outside that of the local indigenous inhabitants. Conflicts over land and free passage led to violence, and by the 1860s, this violence had degraded into what was referred to officially by the U.S. War Department as the Apache Wars, if you will. It's a beautiful spot. I've been here. It's called Apache Pass, okay? And Apache Pass is important to what I want to try to accomplish today. It's both a focus for the hostilities that are reported in a variety of forms. The historical material for this time period is replete with numerous examples of quote-unquote raids and depredations, and the Apache Pass became, I think, an incredible, powerful symbol, all right, of this emerging hysteria, really. If you read the materials, you can see how this is evolving, and we're going to talk about this in some detail as we move forward. The actual pass was an important route as one was traveling from the Dos Cabezas Mountains and onward through the Chiricahua Mountains. This is exactly the area in which the Chiricahua bands of the Apache were located and had been in residence for centuries, if not millennia. As a freshwater spring, Apache Spring was an incredibly important part of this landscape. It provided a dependable source of water through, by all accounts, over years of far-ranging rainfall and different climatic conditions. And the indigenous peoples of the area obviously were incredibly dependent upon seeps, springs, and seasonal creeks and other drainages as an important component of their life cycles as they moved about this area to follow seasonal patterns of game and vegetal resources. So in some ways, Apache Springs is definitely a crossroads, and the evidence, the archaeological evidence, well preserved in the American Southwest, shows that dozens and dozens of trails from far off crisscross and ultimately converge at Apache Springs, so that this was obviously an incredibly important place, not just for the water resources, but one can easily infer that this was a place in which people gathered and shared ideas and other aspects of cultural richness. The Apache leader Cochise, which a lot of people are aware of, this was one of his favorite camping points, and he and many members of his band used this as one of their favorite camping spots in the winter and the spring. There was lots and lots of fuel available, game. It was high enough where the game was still present and hadn't gone completely into the lowland valleys. And it's safe to say that at the time of the 1850s and the major points of incursion of Euro-Americans into this area, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of Apache people living in this major region and dependent upon this as a major source of water. Now we're going to get down to business. threat of attack by the Apache became a common theme in the propaganda perpetuated against indigenous people by colonial interests in the American Southwest in the mid-19th century. The term Apache and its negative connotations were popularized through dime novels, followed by feature films. And here we have Harper's Weekly. This is 1888. Okay? So this is exactly in the moment that I'm going to expand upon here in just a little bit. The Buffalo Bill piece is from 1905, and the Wild West magazine is from the teens. But you see this incredible pattern of this continuous repackaging of this myth of the dreaded circumstances and conditions of Apacheria. And this is where the Apache people become vilified in the minds of people who had never traveled any further east than Ohio or Pittsburgh. This, of course, is followed quickly by the advent of movies, and of course, these are two of the more famous ones, Fort Apache. Again, it becomes this symbol for all sorts of prejudices and alleged disparities, and really is part of myth building. Is what I would call it, is that if you look at this material over a long period of time, you can see how this myth of the Apache unfolds and how it continuously is accessed and utilized for a wide range of political and economic purposes. And then ultimately to DC Comics with the Apache Kid, all right? And then one of my favorites, this is Apache Chief. By Marvel. He was created in the 1970s in an attempt to try to add ethnic diversity to the Super Friends. Superman and his buddies were deemed to be far too white and far too middle class in their orientation. So we had this advent of all of these ethnic-oriented superheroes during this time. And of course, being a child of the 50s, it was Rin Tin Tin, we can't forget this, that television took over this role. And of course, the German Shepherd is part of the effort of the quote-unquote cavalry at Fort Apache, and he undertakes all of these exploits. So it's the same story that's being repackaged for over 150 years. This is the official map that's given out by the National Park Service for Fort Bowie. Fort Bowie was constructed in close proximity to Apache Pass and Apache Springs. It was built, like most forts in the American West, as a means of trying to subjugate the indigenous peoples, to clear the path for expanded European emergence and more importantly, settlement and exploitation of these regions. So these are here to enforce, basically, the theft of land and resources and contribute to, if not the outright control of indigenous peoples, but their dislocation. These are the remains of Fort Bowie. And the reason I show them to you, it's not very engaging, but it's important to the story, I think, in that in the brochures that are given out by the National Park Service, they make a particular point in stating that they have organized the historic site in such a manner that the parking lot is quite a distance from the actual ruins. And there's very little to see there other than some interpretive signing and a set of National Park Service restrooms, right? So everyone that goes there wants to see the ruins of the fort. The story is told, right? But the interpretive component and the point that I think could easily be missed but is central to what I want to try to accomplish today is that they say that they did this so that the visitors can have this experiential learning environment, all right, in which they suffer, all right, and that they have to walk through the desert and the heat. They have to dodge the barbs on the plants, and they want them to understand not the physical environment. They don't want them to understand the landscape and the climate and the lack of moisture and humidity. What they want them to understand, and they're very explicit about this, is how much the soldiers suffered. How much they suffered to protect that past, all right? To save the lives of white people, all right? And this is blatant. It's not quite in those terms. I've gone too far there. But they do make this point that it's all about, if you go out there, the message that you would take away if this is the only information that you knew about Fort Bowie and Apache Pass is that a lot of Anglo soldiers, of cavalry people, went out there and sacrificed and suffered, okay? That's the message that you take away. So, the term Apache continues to be synonymous with Indian deprivations and savagery and in the imaginations of the American people. This popular view is at best highly biased and at worst simply not true. While violence and raiding were undeniable aspects of life in this region in the 18th and 19th centuries, the reality is that the historical data supports a very different interpretation of the circumstances and events that underlie this chapter in American history. Similar to the plight of the majority of Native communities, the Apache were often victims of corrupt agents and officials, dishonest business dealings, territorial encroachment, deceit, murder, and massacre. An alternative interpretation of the so-called Apache Wars might view them as heroic efforts to protect family, defend land, and ensure an ancient way of life. Now, I'm not trying to give an apologetic reinterpretation of the events. This is borne out. If you go back and you look at the data, all right, if you actually go, people understand very, very little about this thing that's bandied about in American history called, quote unquote, the Indian Wars. Okay? In most instances, this does not fit the definition of war. In most instances, if one was able to do some sort of quantitative assessment, some sort of tally, some sort of balance sheet, all right, starting with the most precious, that being the life of individuals, okay, individuals lost, wounded. If we look at issues of mortality, both that inflicted through violence and that inflicted through malevolent means such as infectious disease and malnutrition. If we look at the economic equation, all right, of the cost versus the benefit from the perspective of the Anglo-U.S. Department of War, no matter what type of metric you want to bring to this equation, it doesn't bear out, all right? It just doesn't justify the type of expenditures in both cash, equipment, and individuals that were sent out to fight the quote-unquote Indian Wars. To be quite honest with you, it is an ultimate myth. It is an incredible package of propaganda that was used in order to leverage the political power, the political participation, the consent of the American people that was necessary in order to keep fueling this war machine, okay? We had a massive military establishment after the Civil War, and none of them wanted to give up their commission, right? Particularly the officer corps. So, what happens? In 1866, the U.S. government seized Apache lands and forced the majority of the Apache bands to consolidate on the San Carlos Reservation. Geronimo's band, and this is Geronimo on the left, the most horse. Geronimo's band, among others, made periodic breakouts between 1876 and 1882. Only to return to the reservation in attempts to try to negotiate new terms and new sets of circumstances in which they might find some peaceable solution to this, in which most paramount to him was that they could remain in their sacred homelands of Apacheria. In 1885, Generals Crook and Miles employed 5,000 troops, okay, who marched for months on end and ultimately made great fanfare in the newspapers back east of their great success in finally bringing Geronimo and his band of savages under control and into confinement. That was 5,000 mounted, heavily armed U.S. troops and 28 Apache members of Geronimo's band. What they're doing is they're hiding out in the Chiricahua Mountains, all right, moving back and forth between Mexico. And it's part of the story that's gaining some traction, right? But this is a consistent theme in all of these quote-unquote successful campaigns, okay, positive contributions to the Indian Wars, is that it wasn't until members of other Apache bands were employed as scouts, all right, that there was any hope that Miles would be successful in bringing in Geronimo and his folks. Total removal of Chiricahua Apaches from Arizona was a popular position in 1886. Ultimately, the U.S. decided to exile all of Chiricahuas on the reservation and attempted to conform even those who had stayed on the reservation, who had complied with the military orders and had participated, probably not gleefully, but at least had participated in the forced assimilation programs that were enacted on the San Carlos Reservation, all of them were declared prisoners of war and immediately put into chains and prepared to be taken into captivity. All right. One of the things that I find incredibly interesting about, and something I want to try to learn more, is that this period that they're entering into as prisoners of war reaches absurd levels with respect to exactly what does that mean. Okay, we get a very clear impression of what a prisoner is. We get another idea based on our perceptions of what a prisoner of war is, but none of that, in my opinion, accurately describes situation, circumstances and experiences of the Chiricahuas. Okay, so here's Geronimo and his folks. They're at Fort Sam Houston. This is an incredibly long process. It takes basically a year for them to arrive. They're all originally sentenced to imprisonment at Fort Marion in Florida. And what they were told was that approximately 500 Chiricahuas were placed on trains and they were shipped east, and they were told that they would be incarcerated for 2 years. And at the end of this 2 years, all would be forgiven and they would be repatriated back to their beloved homelands and their kinfolk in the American Southwest. Okay, so most of them, including 164 children, this is a piece of the puzzle that we don't see. This process of imprisonment had been utilized for a number of decades. It was used successfully here in Oklahoma, the imprisonment of numerous members of the Kiowas, the Comanches, the Cheyennes, the Plains Apache, the Arapaho, who were sent to Fort Marion in Florida. And incarcerated for various periods of time. This was a grand experiment in enforced acculturation. Okay? The Apache situation is so different. The one thing I want to mention about here is that it's clear that this was a spectacle. It's clear that there was an advance press team of sorts. Okay, the fact that so many newspaper people were at each and every quote-unquote rest stop, all right, in which the prisoners were allowed to leave the train, that this thing was completely orchestrated, okay? And that this propaganda machine, that this continuous flow of information, the spectacle of the movement of these wild Apache warriors, okay, their imprisonment, their forced relocation, that again, it's part of this machine that perpetuates this highly stereotypic and oftentimes, I think, a totally exploited situation for the benefit, again, of political and economic interests far beyond the immediate concerns of the Chiricahua Apache people. Most, including 164 children, were sent to Fort Marion in St. Augustine, Florida. Some 17 men, the younger members who were thought to be those most guilty, if you will, absolutely no trials, all right, this is all just a matter of statements from the military issues, were actually separated from their families and sent nearly 400 miles away to Fort Pickens, where they were forced to engage in hard labor. These are truly the prisoners, I think, that fit the model. They were shackled. They were confined to locked cells. They fit the definition, from my perspective, of a prisoner in each and every way, and more importantly, to basically be tortured through the diets that they were given, the living conditions, and then forced to conduct hard labor, basically splitting rocks for the sake of splitting rocks, day in, day out, during the time of their confinement. Fort Pickens was a deserted fort on Santa Rosa Island in Pensacola Bay. So they truly were. I mean, it's an island, all right? So that it conjures up all notions of prison camps, if you will. So by 1889, to give you some sense of what's going on here, the harsh conditions and more importantly, infectious disease in southern Florida at this time, that 119 of the original 498 Chiricahuas had expired within just 1 year of their arrival in Florida. Forget that I see before what you see. This is actually a group of, I think Kyle is, but probably Cheyenne's also, okay? So these are prisoners from the 1870s at Fort Marion. And you can see that one of the things that they did was to put them in military uniforms. The reason I show you this slide is because of this fellow on the far, on your far left. That's General Pratt, okay? And General Pratt is the architect of a lot of this forced assimilation policy, in that he is a master of using captive populations in order to conduct his social experiments in acculturation and assimilation. So Pratt is there to receive the Apaches, if you will. And what he does is that he takes children to Carlisle, all right, forcibly removes them. And most of them were taken to, 106 were taken to Carlisle. And they're among some of the first students that Pratt works with in this environment, in which he physically separates them from their families. One of the things that Pratt invents, in my opinion, is the classic before and after photograph, right? All right. So if this isn't testament of civilizing and assimilation, what is, right? In that cutting the hair, forced uniforms, rough wool, the uniformity of it, these aren't clothes, these are uniforms, the same shoes, the forced instruction in domestic science, if you will, and so on and so forth. But these are important to bring to the forefront, I think, of some sort of overview of the history of the ethno-history of the Apache people, is that these people are being experimented on, all right, against their will. All right. So fast forward a bit, and by the 1890s, certain segments of American society had adopted an increasing set of progressive values and views, particularly for these lingering issues with respect to the manner in which Native peoples and indigenous peoples in general, but Native peoples in particular, had been dealt with by the United States government. And some of these were Christian reformers. There's a big literature on this. Historians have done a fantastic job about talking about the various aspects of that were set into place by the Grant Peace Policy in 1869, in which he removed the administration of Indian Affairs from the War Department, and at that point gave it to a variety of religious denominations. So this is where it's obviously has its own complicated story, and most certainly did not always and most often did not serve the immediate needs of their constituents. But nevertheless, there was this movement, and social reformers in the early 1890s started to call for something to be done, all right, as news started to seep out. And again, it's a very small news stream, all right? And what's happening is you get a dissipation of the propaganda and the exploitation of the Apache story for extracurricular means. And the story of their loss and their plight, their disease, the horrid conditions. They're in a rotting fort that was built several hundred years beforehand and had been abandoned. So this is all a way of getting around to saying that they were moved to Alabama, right? What a reprieve. And so they're moved to another abandoned military compound called Mount Vernon, in which cabins were rehabilitated for them. So they're actually out of this cell-like barrack structure and into individual family homes, so that you can see here. But again, it's all about forced assimilation. These are still individuals whose formal official status is prisoner of war. Right? They have no rights. Right? They have no freedom. Right? So that they're easy prey. All right, to these continued efforts at forced assimilation. And here you have a group of young school girls, always under the watchful eye. I mean, I think this photograph speaks volumes to me. All right, nobody's looking happy to me. So, in this same movement, in this same time period, ultimately culminates so that in 1894, the 259, remember, 500 were taken, so that by 1894, there were only 259 remaining, men, women, and children. But they were boarded yet on another plane, or excuse me, plane, right? Jeez. So much for history, right? So they got on the jet, and they landed at Fort Sill, okay? U.S. Congress actually had to pass a law. This is part and parcel of being declared a prisoner of war, right? The military no longer has the right to pardon you, right? All they are empowered to do is to imprison you, okay? But ultimately, through a congruence of forces, the military is really wanting to get out of this prisoner of war business. Imagine that. But ultimately, they are freed by congressional act. The entire Congress had to approve the fact that these 260-some-odd remaining Chiricahua and Warm Springs Apache people were no longer the prisoners of the United States for depredations of war, right? Acts of war. So that what this does, among a number of things, is it makes these Apache peoples the final group to quote unquote be removed, or in a more whitewashed term, relocated in Oklahoma, okay, or Indian Territory as it was. So, the Apache prisoners once again were told that Fort Sill, I said they weren't prisoners. The Congress agreed that they could be moved to Fort Sill. They are still prisoners of war. I'm sorry, I got ahead of myself there. It's just that they enabled them to relocate them to Fort Sill. It took congressional action because they're prisoners of war. All right. So what they were told was that ultimately, at the end of their incarceration, that Fort Sill was going to be closed. This is at the advent, all right? A lot of people don't realize this, but these forts that were built during the European period of European expansion into the American West, that they're under great threat because of budgetary reasons, right? Every story circles back around, right? So that all sorts of political powers are brought to bear. So one of the reasons that the Apache are approved to move to Fort Sill is that there's this growing sentiment to keep the fort there. What was about to happen was the reservations of Southwest Oklahoma were going to be allotted. Okay? And the plan was, the grand scheme of things from the government was, that once this took place, of course these individuals would become yeoman farmers, they would give up their indigenous beliefs and values, and there would no longer be the need for a fort to police the southern plains, okay? And Fort Sill would close and go away. So what the Apaches were told upon their arrival in Oklahoma, that in a short time, all right, this is right on the cusp of allotment. Actually, allotment has already taken place among some of these groups, that Fort Sill would be closed and it would become their territory, okay? So fast forward to 1910. The Apaches are ready to claim the lands. But a powerful group of politicians, all right? Oklahoma is a state now, a senator, and more importantly, economic leaders from the Lawton area were successful in lobbying Congress to keep Fort Sill as a military establishment. So once again, the promise to the Chiricahua and Warm Springs people is completely voided, and they are suddenly told that they have to leave, okay? So it's not like, now we're going to take you here. It's like, you know what? We're done. Enough of this, okay? But you got to leave. You can't stay here. This is going to become a military fort, and you're no longer welcome to stay here, all right? So that what they did was they were pressured to return back, and the story gets very complicated. But basically, the Mescalero Apache inhabitants of the Mescalero Apache agree to take these refugees from Oklahoma. This was both a magnanimous outreach to their kindred Apache peoples, but it was also a political maneuver in that the Europeans were starting to eye the Mescalero reservation, all right? So that land deemed useless and good only for an Indian reservation 15 years previously suddenly had been imagined as a viable resource base. And the Mescaleros were fearful that they were going to suffer another period of encroachment and the loss of land and territory. So they were more than welcome to bring more individuals to their reservation as they tried to bolster both their demographic presence and their political power. Despite the efforts of the government and military officials, about a third of those people refused to leave. They said, enough is enough, we're not going back there, that we've set down roots here. A lot of them had intermarried with members of the Kiowa and the Comanche tribe, the Plains Apache, and they just said, no, enough is enough. You promised us this land, we've suffered for over two decades, and we're just simply not going to leave. So ultimately what was negotiated was a system in which they were allowed to claim allotments, which, for those of you unfamiliar with the process, consisted of about 160 acres of land for a family, okay? So that they were allowed to claim allotments among the Kiowa Apache, parcels of land that no one had claimed or wanted. The other allotments that were opened up to them were parcels of land that had been claimed by individuals who had passed on, okay? So they began to settle onto these allotments. They built frame homes. This is Geronimo's home, for those of you who are Geronimo students of Geronimo. Each family was given 10 acres of land, so it's a reduced allotment. So that what we have is situations where we have 20 or 30 people, actually small bands, living on parcels of land that for other Native Americans were intended for families of nuclear families of six or eight or whatever. They engaged in truck farming out of necessity. There's absolutely no game left on the reservation. They're not allowed to leave. So that they're dependent completely upon government rations of probably substandard beef and basically whatever they could scavenge and grow for themselves. And this is a picture of Geronimo and his family in their pumpkin patch. You know, part of the story is that Geronimo is never freed. He never sees a day of freedom. He's exploited to an incredible extent. This is at the 1905 Louisiana Purchase Exhibition in St. Louis, in which he was ordered to go to this, all right? And if you read some of what's alleged to be his thoughts on his life as a prisoner, of war, he was always conflicted about whether or not to go. The biggest fear that he had was not that his fear was not going to St. Louis. His fear was not going to the fair. It wasn't that he didn't want to interact with people, but by all accounts, he was quite gregarious and very, very engaging, an incredibly talented and intelligent man. What he feared was retribution. The hype was still so strong in the minds of not only the American public, but in the Apache people themselves. He feared that if he left Fort Sill, he would be attacked and killed. All right. And ultimately, he died in captivity. You can go down to Fort Sill. You can see his cell in the cell block, right? And he's not alone. A lot of Apache people died while still imprisoned at Fort Sill. And you can go to the Fort Cemetery, the post cemetery, and there's a particular section that's reserved for the quote-unquote Apache prisoners. And again, this story takes incredibly strange turns and permutations. This is Sam Houser, Alan's father, and I show it to you because he was one of many members who served in a variety of capacities in military units and police forces in and around Fort Sill. He was a decorated member of Troop L, which was a troop comprised of Native peoples from a variety of tribes who resided in and around the vicinity of Fort Sill. So, fast forward, these folks took incredible advantage, the Fort Sill Apache, as they came to be known, from the Oklahoma Indian Welfare Act of 1936. This was the opportunity through which Native communities were provided the chance to create constitutional governments, to reformulate, and in the Collier area, on the heels of that, to exercise sort of these initial forays into realms of sovereignty and self-determination. And then ultimately through this incredibly long and complicated process of providing documentation, for decades the Apache people, Chiricahua and Warm Springs, were able to attain federal recognition in 1976. Your left is the first chairperson of the Fort Sill Apache tribe. This is Mildred Cleghorn, a very talented artist that many of you may know her through her work as a doll maker. She was the last Chiricahua born in captivity. So she represents this incredible bridge, this incredible movement forward. She served until 1995. She was a tireless advocate for both modern education and for attempts to preserve and perpetuate, to revitalize traditional Apache values and traditional elements of Apache culture. And of course, on the right is Mr. Houser, who was the first Fort Sill Apache to be born in freedom. Okay? So to me, this photograph speaks volumes, obviously. There's a great photo. I couldn't find one of sufficient resolution to share with you today, but there's this wonderful photograph of both of these with William Clinton at the White House when Mr. Houser was awarded a Medal of Honor for his accomplishments as one of the great American sculptors of our age. But it's this wonderful photo in which you have Mrs. Cleghorn on one side and Mr. Houser on the other, and a great big smile on Bill Clinton's face. So, quickly, following federal recognition, the tribe went to work with great gusto. This is their entertainment center that sits near Lawton, Oklahoma, amazingly successful, a first-class facility. But moving beyond this, like many tribal communities in Oklahoma, utilizing the proceeds from these endeavors to build a more stable and vibrant and diversified economy to serve the needs of both the tribe and its members. Okay? One of my favorites right here. So, coming to the close here. In 1998, the tribe purchased a small tract of land in New Mexico. And in 2002, the land was placed into federal trust. Sitting between Tucson and El Paso on Interstate 10, the rest stop is a natural way station for travelers and has been operating as the Apache Homelands Entertainment Center since 2008. They're not quite there yet, but they're back in New Mexico. There are the mountains, right? This is very much by the current chairperson, very much acknowledged as a foothold. Okay. Obviously, the placement of the land in federal trust is a precursor to entering into entertainment and gaming. The greatest opponents of this, they've been embraced by the city fathers of Deming, which would be the closest urban center. This sits about, I think, 60 or 80 miles east of Deming on I-10. But the folks who are opposing them and who are lobbying with great gusto and bringing a fair amount of cash to the table are other native communities who are entrenched in gaming in New Mexico. And there are a number of Pueblo groups who have the Fort Sill Apache in New Mexico in court over this, and it remains to be seen exactly how this will all be resolved. Quickly, I want to move through these. This is their website. I noticed that increasingly their cyber presence of the Fort Sill Apache is at least in cyberland and if not in reality, increasingly set in New Mexico. Okay, as this website grows, I see a diminishment on the website that focuses here in Oklahoma. But I think it's interesting to move through these screenshots, if you will. So a Fort Sill Apache home, the land of our ancestors, and finally, this is home. So, Apache artists and tribal members are accessing a range of forms to preserve and share the story of their ancestors. The film 2 Year Promise is only one among many works that are out there to popularize the story of the Apache prisoners of war, and again, coming from community perspectives. In 2014, this year, just a bit ago, I believe, the Fort Sill Apache hosted a 100th anniversary celebration to commemorate the end of their prisoner of war status of the Chiricahua and Warm Springs Apache people who became the Fort Sill Apache tribe. And Jack, have I got 5 minutes? Sure. Not giving them back. So So as you can see, the future, I think, is wide open in that one of the things that we have at the museum right now, I got to get my pitch in for the SAM, so I might as well get it done, is that we have Ramp It Up, the skateboard culture in Native communities, in which we feature various artists from the Apache community. I believe we have one of Mr. Miles' pieces in the show, so I'm anxious to learn more about that. But it speaks to the importance of skate culture and skate parks in Native communities, again, as they seek to deal not only with the modern circumstances, but to perpetuate certain core cultural values that are important to them. I want to go back to this comment, all right? I can't get away from this comment in that National Park Service brochure from Fort Bowie. About this harsh and unforgiving. I mean, the language is just incredible. I can't believe that made it through the National Park Service editing process. Those guys usually do a pretty good job of keeping an eye out for those sorts of deviations off the trail from what I consider to be fair and objective interpretation. So I want to use the remainder of my time to share with you just a little bit of the work that came from Keith Basso. All right, an anthropologist who's worked extensively with the Apache people. And I want to offer it up as a clear juxtaposition to the material that I presented from the National Park Service's interpretation of the environment found at Apache Pass. Working with members of the Western Apache, Basso collected a series of stories that incorporate geographic knowledge, conceptions of landscape, particularly aesthetics of landscape. I mean, really serious philosophical inquiries into exactly how does the landscape resonate with human beings. And then lastly, complex intricacies of historical narrative. Okay. Basso states that place names in particular serve as vehicles for ancestral authority, a form of knowledge intended to be applied, to be brought up and acted upon, to be incorporated into the smallest corners of personal and social experiences. In his book, Wisdom Sits in Places, Basso presents a series of selected stories and succinct spoken text in which Apache people express claims about their language and the landscape in which they reside. Some of the more important for my purpose today include the following examples. The land is always stalking people. The land makes people live right. The land looks after us. The land looks after people. This is Annie Peaches, age 77 in 1978. Our children are losing the land. It doesn't go to work on them anymore. They don't know the stories about what happened at these places. That's why some of them get into trouble. Ronnie Lupe, age 42 in 1978. We used to survive only off the land. Now it's no longer that way. Now we live only with money, so we need jobs. But the land, it still looks after us. We know the names and the places where everything happened, so we stay away from badness. Nick Thompson, age 64 in 1989. These stories of place are brilliantly succinct in structure and length. Experienced Apache narrators say that they will depict just enough for you to see what happened, just enough to know how it happened, and perhaps a glimpse as to why it happened. And they encourage people to add on to these depictions however you see fit. This is a process described in the Apache language literally as opening up thinking. And one more. I think of the mountain called White Rocks Lie Above in a compact cluster. I encourage you to buy Wisdom Sits in Places. The ways in which place names are constructed, all right, and the thought processes that are involved caused me to absolutely believe that these are ancient ideas about the landscape. I think that the mountain called White Rock lies above in compact cluster, as if it were my maternal grandmother. I recall stories of how it was once at that mountain. The stories told to me were like arrows. Elsewhere, hearing the mountain's name, I see it. The name is like a picture. Stories go to work on you like arrows. Stories make you write. Stories make you replace yourself. Powerful. That's powerful. So for me, the connections between memory of landscape, even those visited long ago, or perhaps those never seen, and the narrative performance of the Apache people can be seen to be much more than mnemonic devices used to help construct complex cognitive maps of geography. They work instead to supply connections to the ancestors, to model right living, to overcome adversity through creative enactment, through the telling of stories, and through the creation of visual works. For me, this connection was made real when I was first able to experience Allan Houser's work in natural settings. Okay, outside the museum, outside in the world, if you will. Such as sculpture parks, the one in Santa Fe is one that comes to mind immediately, where the works are free to resonate with the landscape and the stories can be seen to accomplish the work of the ancestors. It is in this tie to homeland, both lived and imagined, that trumps diaspora and energizes perseverance. And I want to close, if this will work for me. Gods of technology sometimes do not like me. This is an amazingly think summary of what I'm trying to say.
There are sheep by Eclancy. The Apache country is very beautiful because they had nice land and cool water to drink. In Arizona, the men had to fight. The government sent all the Apaches to a prison in Florida. If you're Apache and you go to prison, you didn't do anything wrong. You just got sent to prison. The children got sent to Carlisle, Pennsylvania. Their clothes got stripped. The boys got their hair cut, and they couldn't speak their language anymore. Perico is my hero because he is my great-great-grandfather. He went to prison for being Apache, and he went through all of the captivity. My dad, an Apache singer, is trying to teach me some Apache songs because, you know, he wants me to go through the Apache life.
Great to be find those gems where a six-year-old basically delivers a powerful version of what I just rambled on for 45 minutes. So thank you so much for your time.